Hi guys. Weather and climate events do not rely on deterministic patterns because of the chaotic behavior of the atmospheric system. Long-term weather forecast is something unachievable for us in spite of the incredible advances in science and technology. Meteorology experts have the capacity only to predict the conditions and temperatures of the following several days in high probabilities. For this reason, farmers shall always be prepared to protect their crops against bad weather conditions. Today we are going to talk about frost protection. There are a lot of information about frost protection methods on the internet. But almost all the sources I run into are based on the book published by Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. In order to have a better understanding about this topic, I strongly recommend this book, which is available on the website of FAO. There are two defined frost categories in the literature, advective and radiative. Advective frosts are related with cold air movements in large scale in a well-mixed wind atmosphere and the temperature that is often sub-zero during the daytime. These frosts are difficult to combat since they last longer and weather is cold everywhere. Radiative frosts are related with cooling from Earth due to energy loss by radiation during clear witness lights, and they are associated with temperature inversions, which means temperature increases with height. The weather temperature is greater than 0 Celsius degree during day. Under clear nighttime skies, more heat is radiated away from the surface than is received, so the temperature drops. Cold air on hilltops drains downhill and settles in low spots just like the flow of water because cold air is denser than warm air. The temperature falls faster near radiating surface, causing a temperature inversion to form. Radiative frosts are much easier to cope with compared to advective frosts. In some cases, both advective and radiative frosts may take place in the same region. Another important issue in frost prediction is to know sensitivity of your crop at different development stages such as bud, flowers, and small nuts. According to your research by H. Connell, buds are much more resistant to cold air than other forms, whereas small nut is the most susceptible stage of almond to injury. Therefore, possible dates of these development stages should be considered before plantation. Prior to the decision on the frost protection method, the meteorological data of the region in the past should be diligently analyzed. The weather conditions and the highest and lowest temperature values in the nearest weather station for each day of the possible blooming dates can be obtained from the National Weather Service. In this way, you may have a general idea and projection about possible frost types and dates in your region. Before planting our orchard, I got these data for the last 10 years from mid-March to end of April for each year. I concluded that any cultivar blooming in March is definitely not suitable for our region. In April, the air temperature may drop sub-zero degrees in several days. As far as I understand from the data, the type of frost usually occurring in our region in April, especially after mid-April, is radiative frost. Frost protection methods are categorized in two groups, passive and active methods. Passive protection comprises of methods applied before a frost night to help avoid the need for active protection. First passive method is site selection, which is really important in frost protection. Low spots are very risky in terms of radiative frost. On the other hand, the plants on slopes are generally exposed to more wind during advective frosts. It is also important to talk with local people to determine if any macro-scale climate exists in the region. Another passive method is plant selection. It is significant to choose plants blooming late to reduce the probability of frost damage. As for almond varieties, the extra late blooming cultivars such as Penta, Marinada, Macaco, maybe Tardona or Avigio Lauren can be preferred. By the way, now I am just emphasizing and evaluating blooming periods of these cultivars. Before making your decision, please examine all other features of them as well. Concerning active protection methods, I will just talk about fans and some irrigation systems. I will not elaborate on other methods like heaters. Using fans is one of the most well-known and effective methods to cope with radiative frost. Fans basically mix cold and warm air below and above the inversion layer and increase the temperature near ground. However, they are useless, even harmful during advective frosts. Another active frost protection method is irrigation. Some farmers use under-tree sprinklers. The idea is to reduce radiation and provide a mild microclimate since the water coming from well is warmer than air. A few degrees of protection is possible with such a system. On the other hand, use of overtree sprinklers is much more effective method. In this scenario, water is continuously applied at a sufficient rate to prevent temperature of the trees from dropping too low between pulses of watering. When water droplets strike a flower, bud or small nut, water will freeze and the heat releasing from cooling of water and phase change temporarily raise the plant temperature. However, due to radiation, evaporation and sublimation, some energy is lost. To replace these losses and to keep the temperature of the plant in non-risky levels, water should be reapplied frequently. As long as there is a liquid ice mixture on the plants, with water dripping of icicles, the coated plant parts will maintain their temperature about 0 Celsius degree. However, an inadequate precipitation rate may cause all of the water to freeze and, in turn, the temperature of the coated plants will again start to fall. Overtree irrigation can be used in both radiative and advective frost, so long as the wind does not affect the uniform distribution of precipitation over the plant. It provides a good protection down to minus 7 degrees. Everything looks good about irrigation, but application on the field is not that easy. First of all, this method requires very large amount of water. Depending on the total canopy size of your plantation, you may need 20 metric tons of water an hour per hectare, even for a targeted micro-sprinkler system, which is the most efficient one among the irrigation systems in terms of water consumption. In an advective frost, risky temperatures may last for days, and you may have to use thousands of tons of water to protect your plant. In such a case, first things first, it will be the water capacity and sufficient rate of flow. If so, then due to over-irrigation, it would be very difficult to step on the ground of the orchard for other cultivation and management activities due to heavy muddy surface. Excessive irrigation may hamper pollination as well. Most importantly, if this process somehow fails because of some reasons such as energy interruption, shortage of water, the ice load on the trees may damage not only your crops but also the trees themselves. Overplant sprinklers should be started and kept running so long as the wet bulb temperature is lower than the critical temperature. Wet bulb temperature is much lower than normal air temperature if the relative humidity is low. As an example, when you put on a wet t-shirt in a dry region, you will feel colder than when you do the same in a place near sea. The reason is the evaporation rate is higher on the fields with dry air. Evaporation gives rise to loss of heat and decreases the temperature. The same case is valid in irrigation. If you stop irrigation before the wet bulb temperature does not exceed the critical temperatures, your plants will rapidly cool down because of high evaporation rate and frost damage will probably occur. If you really intend to protect your plants with an overtree irrigation system, make sure you have sufficient water source. If you are not sure about your source, build an irrigation pool as big as possible. Before starting your sprinklers, take into consideration how long you may have to keep them running. Otherwise, the results might be catastrophic. Thank you for watching. Please share with me your opinions and experience about frost protection methods on the comments section below. Please subscribe my channel to follow my new videos. Stay safe and bye.